I'm Yev.
And I'm James.
And we're here for another episode of Stocks and Storage, this time talking about earnings calls. Ever since we went public, we've had this new motion that we've had to do. And so every now and again, we have to do something called an earnings call. And up until recently, I just thought that they were something that existed, but it was like a private thing for people that used to own stock or that have stock or whatever in that company, right? So kind of like a private club type of an event. But now that we're having them, I'm seeing that anyone can like go and listen in and even in some cases ask questions. And it feels really dry. So I can't make heads or tails out of what's being said. It feels like it was taken through an army of lawyers before the people are actually doing the presentation. Take us through an earnings call and why it is the way that it is.
So earnings calls, they're actually not legally required. You do have to report your results on a quarterly basis in a timely fashion. That's one thing that the SEC or Securities Exchange Commission requires for publicly listed companies in the United States. But most companies do earnings calls so that they can provide context. You know, I mean, a press release, you know, it's a very limited way to communicate. In an earnings call, you can talk a lot more about, you know, some of the specifics and provide additional details that you can't get across in a press release. And also it gives people a chance to ask questions. So, you know, for example, you know, we launched a new product called B2 Reserve last quarter. We think that's an important new way to sell B2. And so, you know, we got to talk about that and people got to ask questions about that.
And why is it so dry?
Well, I think you're talking about the legalese at the beginning. I mean, like that part's no fun for anybody, but you know, investing in stocks is risky. And many times, you know, companies are gonna say things about the future and their potential results, and there's uncertainty. And so, you know, people just need to be reminded that, you know, we don't actually know the future. That's just something, a risk you take on when you buy a stock.
Yeah, so it's basically a way for us to say, hey, we are planning and are going to execute on the following stuff happening. Now, we are not Nostradamus, which I think is the singular of Nostradamus. And so you need a couple of disclaimers at the top.
Yeah.
And so sometimes there's like a Q&A session at the end. I know we use a platform called Say, I believe, that allows people to toss us some Q&A questions. And I think there's some kind of, you know, share allotment that gets tallied. It was kind of cool when I was looking at it. But who asks those questions? What are they typically? And what can the company actually answer?
Well, usually, you know, what we would say is actually pretty unique. Most companies are not doing that. But usually it's sell-side analysts that are asking questions on the call. That was the topic of a previous episode of Stocks and Storage. And the reason why is because those guys are very in tune to the issues that are pertinent to the company, and you know, they have financial models. And so the idea is these sell-side analysts are gonna ask questions that are gonna be most useful for investors because, you know, they know the business. Now, separately, we have this new platform called Say Technologies we've been using. We're not the only one using them. Some other well-known companies like Tesla use it. But basically, it's a way for us to crowdsource questions from investors who might not otherwise get a chance to ask a question. And so you can, it's actually like Reddit. You can go in there, you can prove that you own the shares of our company. You can enter a question and other investors can decide if they want to hear that question answered, and they upvote it. And you know, we've tried to hit the biggest questions, the most popular questions, every time we do a call.
That fits perfectly in line with our company culture because we're very open and we like to be as communicative as possible. So kind of opening it up to just not the analysts, but everyone else is actually right in our wheelhouse. So it's kind of cool that these technologies exist that allow us to do so.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. It did not exist when I was an analyst.
Well, thanks, James. And we'll see you on the next episode of
Stocks and Storage.
It was right around that time when I realized that like I couldn't go to a Blockbuster and rent a rated R movie because I wasn't 17, but the library never carded.
Next time on
Yeah.
Puberty and Storage.
Stick with me.